from, sir.
Yeah.
Sure, sir.
Hello, sir. Murthy sir, hello.
Yes, I can hear you. Namaskar. Namaskar, sir.
Namaskar. Namaskar, Murthy sir. How are you?
Well, doing fine. Doing fine.
We also have, sir, our Vice Dean, sir, Dr. S.B. Chaudhary, Satyajit Chaudhary, sir, there on the platform. Hello, yes, sir.
नमस्ते सर.
नमस्ते चौधरी साहब. एंड टेलर साहब को कल मिले थे हम इन द रन अप.
ओके.
यस सर, वी मेट यस्टरडे इन मोका.
या 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 या.
सो सिटिंग देयर इन दिल्ली सर, टेंपरेचर आई थिंक इज वेरी लो.
या टेंपरेचर एंड पोल्यूशन इज आल्सो वेरी वेरी सिवियर.
ओके. टेंपरेचर आई थिंक टुडे इन या डिसेंबर इट्स रीचिंग टू 6 डिग्री आई थिंक.
Yeah, I think this pollution problem is severe. Cold is okay, but cold and pollution both together is creating problems.
Making the things more intense. Yeah,
especially old people and children.
Right, sir.
But yeah, Vadodara is an excellent. I think winter is very good in Vadodara, yeah, as I understand.
Have you visited, sir?
Many times, sir. I've visited.
Yes, sir. You told your in-laws. That means,
My wife is from Vadodara.
Yes, sir. Yes, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, sir. So you must have visited Vadodara many times. Has to visit, I think, because it is your in-laws are staying in Vadodara, sir.
No, they are in Ahmedabad.
Okay, sir.
My wife studied there in MS University.
Okay, sir. If I can ask, sir, from which faculty, ma'am is?
She did her architecture from there.
Architecture. Oh, architecture. Architecture is a part of the Faculty of Technology, sir.
I know. Yes. The same building.
Okay, sir. So, ma'am is actually from our faculty. We can say.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Not only from. University work from our faculty technology itself, sir.
Yes, that is true.
Right. I again request.
So you have you have courses in naturally all the courses will be there. Do you have any telecom specific subject? No. Stream? No.
Sir, telecom stream is not there. We have course regarding some communication subject.
Communications, okay.
In which we deal with 12 channel and 24 channel and all those communications channels and wireless and even microwave is not the matter, or I can say medium utilized for communication, but microwave we are also dealing with.
Very good.
With that subject, we have all these details.
Very good, very good.
It is
We are working very closely with four IITs. There is IIT Delhi, IIT Kanpur, IIT Chennai, and IIT Madras and IIT Hyderabad. So we have agreements with them. So now we will think about involving MS University also.
You have to, sir.
More the merrier. Now I'm starting one research and development study center also at TRI. So very soon we'll be starting that. So, we can have some sort of agreement. And there is huge scope in this. And especially the students will be benefited hugely. And a lot of research projects also can be taken up, which will expose the students to the telecom technologies and, what is happening in the world of telecom. So that we can...
Once when you finalize the center at your level, we are very much ascertaining you from our side that any of the backend details or the requirement you will be sending us, we will immediately work on the same, and we'll have a proper interaction between with the authority from TRI, sir, and from our units.
Yeah. Our authority, is mandated to handle, telecom and broadcasting, huge mandate. And we require, a lot of inputs, especially inputs on the aspects of, technology very important, and I'll be talking about that also. You know, so what has happened? You know, the bigger institutes, you know, they are getting you know, tagged to this kind of authorities. For example, SEBI. So all the big institutes which are in finance, and though they are tagged, but there may be many other institutes which should be connected there. Same thing is with CCI, Competition Commission of India. So I think we need to decentralize this kind of research and interactions with the students and also academia. Yeah, that is there. Yeah.
Even Murthy sir can share his views, sir.
Murthy sir ka mute hai.
Sorry. So yeah, it's very encouraging when you talk of involving MS University into the activities of DRI, actually.
Yeah.
So yeah, it is. We are a very strong department. I mean, a very strong faculty, and I think that we can work together for the benefit of students. We have BE students in electrical. We have BE in electronics. Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah.
Jiga sir is also in the meeting. So, with the permission of Dean sir and Chairman,
please go ahead.
Jigar, sir.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. So, first of all, I would like to welcome everyone in our online interaction session. Good evening to one and all. I, Chayant Agrawal, is a student coordinator of this event. On behalf of the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda, welcome you all for today's session on the topic Digital Transformation 5G Deployment in India. Before starting of the session, please follow some webinar etiquettes. I request all participants to keep their microphone on mute and camera off during the session. In case you have any question, then please use the chat box only. You will receive the feedback form session, feedback form link in between the session. So please fill it for the certificate purpose. Now, I would like to request Mit Patel to play the university song.
Sare jan hara
Thanks, Meet, for playing university. So now I would like to invite Tisa Soni to introduce Dr. Jigar Inamdar.
Good evening, one and all present over here. I'll be introducing Dr. Jigar Inamdar, sir, who is pursued BCom LLB, MA in Political Science, PhD in Public Administration. He is Cultural Regional Director, Indian Council for Cultural Relation and Ministry of External Affairs, Government of India. He is current Senate and Syndicate Member of Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda, also advisor and former Honorary Executive Director, Institute of Leadership and Governance Advisor, Triveni Devi Kashinath, Agrawal Management Development Center of Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda. He is also coordinating activities of Swami Vivekanand Gujarat State Youth Board, Ministry of Youth Affairs. Last but not the least, sir, you are an inspiration for today's youth. It is not less than a celebrity honor to have you between us, sir. I request you to address this event by your inspiration words. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Jigar sir, are you there? I think there is any technical error. So now I would like to invite Saksham Khandre for introduce our Dean Faculty of Technology, Professor C.R. Murthy, sir, who may deliver welcome speech. Saksham, over to you.
Thank you, Jayant. Good evening to one and all present here. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce our dean today, Professor C.N. Murthy. Murthy sir has pursued MSc, MTech, and PhD in first class from IIT Mumbai. Some of his professional distinction goes with Fellow of Gujarat Science Academy since 2013, Brain Pool Fellow, Korea Research Foundation, South Korea, Best Oral Presentation, CMSC, Beijing, China, INSA Visiting Fellow, Institute of Science and Technology, South Korea. He has also been the visiting professor at the Royal Institute of Technology, Stockholm, Sweden, and executive committee member of Community Science Center, Vadodara. Some of his academic experience includes being head of Applied Chemistry Department. He is currently the member secretary of Gujarat State Eligibility Test and also Dean of Faculty of Technology and Engineering. He has also work experience at multinational company Johnson & Johnson. He has done some research projects with UGC, UGC, DAE, DST, CSIR, and DRDO. Our dean has had a distinguished career in technology. 50 of his referred journals and more than 70 at national and international conferences have been published so far. We are delighted to have a meeting with you, sir. With this, I would like to welcome Professor C.N. Murthy.
Thank you, Saksham. For the introduction, a very warm welcome to our speaker today, Dr. P.D. Vagila, sir. It's very nice that you have accepted to be part of our technology team, and a very warm welcome to all our young students who have joined us from across the Gujarat, I think, and of course, across India also. So it's interesting that Jayant has been able to organize this very interesting seminar. It's an online seminar where Dr. P.D. Vagela, the chairman of the TRI, is addressing the young students to get into the business, I would say, of communication, telecommunication. And as I read in the newspapers today, actually, if you go for 5G, the speeds are in the range of giga and tera also, it seems. And as I see, this our own laptops work on Mbps only as of today. So that's a great challenge for us. Just to give a brief introduction to my own faculty, we are 14 departments, which includes 11 engineering departments and 3 applied sciences departments. Among these engineering departments, I think most of the students here are from the electrical engineering departments, which offers 2 programs, which is BE Electrical and BE Electronics. We have a very nice campus, almost about 27 acres with around 5,000 students on the campus. And they are very active, very young students. There were some of the best students from across Gujarat come to learn at the MS University of Baroda. And I would say that almost 60% of the students stay on campus. That means they have personal accommodation and all that. Of course, these are pandemic times. And so we are all having the classroom teaching, which we say online, but we are eagerly waiting for the students to come back to the campus so that the campus becomes much more live with students. Otherwise, without students on the campus, it looks like a desert, I would say. So that's one thing. And then our students are also very active in extracurricular activities. Actually, maybe sometime in January and February, we will have students who not only take part in academics very strongly, but also in extracurricular activities, like we have the program called Footprints Paramarsh. So our students, of course, are very active and they take active interest in many of their activities, which are not to do with academics. And this is one of the extramural lectures which they have organized, where one of the distinguished persons, Dr. Vagela, will be addressing the students. They will also, I am sure, that they will know a lot about what is 5G and why it is important for the future of India, which is having more than a billion population. Our campus has about 5,000 students on the campus, and we cater to different engineering disciplines. Apart from electrical engineering, we have mechanical, electrical, mechanical, civil, applied mechanics, metallurgy, chemical. So it's a very old institute. Actually, we already completed 132 years of existence on the same campus, actually. And so we take pride in being one of the pioneering engineering institutes in the state of Gujarat. And of course, it's well known across the world. Our own alumni are there. I mean, all of us know about Vishal Shikha, then Ajay, who is the inventor of the USB, and so on and so forth. We can keep on take pride on this alumni from our own institute. And as I understand, the present speaker, Dr. Vagela, also is linked to us through his own ISWAN. So we hope that he would come back to us in person. We would like to meet him in person. We invite you on some other occasion, and so that we have much more interaction between TRAI and the MS University, the Faculty of Technology and Engineering. Actually, we need a lot of support from technology institutes so that our students can gain a lot and know what is happening in the current world. And with these few words, I once again warmly welcome Dr. P.D. Vagela and all the young students who are there, and my colleagues from the Faculty of Technology and Engineering, Dr. Sajid Chaudhary, Professor Apurva Shah. And I hope that the students take a lot of takeaways from this particular lecture, which Dr. Vagela will be delivering. And I hope that we interact much more between TRAI and the Faculty of Technology and Engineering. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor C.N. Murthy, sir. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Jigar Inamdar, sir, Senate and Syndicate member, the Maharaja Sayajirao University of Baroda, to say a few words about our today's program. Jigar, sir, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Jayan. I would like to thank Professor C.N. Murthy, sir, for providing me an opportunity to connect with all of you. I would like to welcome respected
sir, I think there are
disconnect.
Some.
Okay.
No, yeah.
Just wait for a minute.
He is again connected.
कार्यक्रम नियमित रूप से होते रहे हैं और इसी प्रकार से विशिष्ट महानुभावों को यूनिवर्सिटी में निमंत्रित करके उनके ज्ञान का लाभ हमारे यंग स्टूडेंट्स को मिल पाए ऐसा जो प्रयास है इस प्रयास को कार्यान्वित करने के लिए प्रोफेसर सीएन मूर्ति जी का मार्गदर्शन और जयंत जैसे यंग एंथुजियास्टिक स्टूडेंट्स की मेहनत मैं दोनों को कांग्रेचुलेट करना चाहता हूं और आज हम सभी यहां पर आदरणीय वाघेला जी को सुनने के लिए उपस्थित हैं ऐसे समय में उनके और आपके बीच में ज्यादा समय नहीं लेना चाहिए ये समझते हुए मैं उनका एक बार फिर से स्वागत करते हुए इस प्रकार के यूनिक कार्यक्रमों को आगे ले जाने की भगवान आप सबको शक्ति दे यही प्रार्थना करके मेरी बात पूर्ण करता हूँ आप सबका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद
Thank you very much, Jigar sir, for your blessing. Now, I would like to invite Ms. Khushi to introduce Mr. Hemang Tiller sir, Dean of Students and Program Coordinator of this webinar, who may deliver us the theme of today's topic. Khushi, over to you.
Good evening, everyone. I welcome Hemang sir, who is an associate professor and a chapter advisor in the Department of Electrical Engineering, the Faculty of Technology and Engineering. He is at the position of secretary in Kalabhavan Electrical and Electronics Engineers Alumni Association, and he is also the coordinator in the solar generation at Faculty of Technology of 312 kilowatt. He is a department coordinator of training and placement, even a member at the Green Campus committee for the faculty. He has received 4 years of industrial and 25 years of academic experience, even presented 7 papers in national and international journals and the conferences. And the last but not the least, he was awarded by the Best Teacher Award by the Divya Bhaskar Group in September 2016. I over to you, sir.
The theme about the program was to be delivered by our Vice Dean Sir, Professor Apurva Sa Sir. I warmly welcome P.D. Vaghela Sir again to the program and representing few of the details, friends, to the audience at present available with us. Yes, Vaghela Ji will definitely give us many of the wide aspect of 5G deployment in India. Let me just inform you the key differences in 4G and 5G. Actually, we are talking from so long when Mukesh Ambani ji has introduced the 4G technology in India. Many of the laymen are understanding G, 4G, 2G, what is the actual terms. So we can, I'll just take a few seconds only to tell you some technical details regarding the difference between the 4G and 5G. 4G at present, can yes, friends, we have to compare the speed and latency. Remember two words, speed and latency. Now let us compare 4G and 5G speed point of view. Currently 4G can reach up to a maximum top speed of 100 Mbps, or maximum you can have some other advanced connection, then it may be 150 Mbps. So real world performance is generally no more than 35 Mbps. If you have seen your download speed or upload speed, may not be more than 35 Mbps. On the other side, if we are talking about 5G, then it is 100 times faster, friends, than 4G, with a top theoretical speed around 20 gigabytes per second. This is the basic difference between the 4G and 5G speed point of view. Now let us also understand the another term, latency. What is this latency? Latency is a measure of time It takes a packet of information to travel between two points. Friends, in 4G latency currently is about 50 milliseconds. 50 milliseconds. While in 5G network, it will be expected to shrink very impressive value of about 1 millisecond, friends, from 50 milliseconds of 4G. So this is the basic difference between 4G and 5G. But I think Vaghela sir will definitely help us to know about more details from the policy of the government. But electronics and informative technology, Ashwini Vaishnav announced during Times Now Summit 2021, he said an entire made in India stack of 5G hardware and software is around 70 to 75% is expected by February 2022. The 5G stack will be ready in its whole entity, friends. So I rather with all this much details to the audience about the theme of the program, I again heartily welcome Vaghela sir, and over to Jayant.
Thank you, sir, for the theme of today's program. Now I would like to again invite you for give introduction of our keynote speaker, IAS PD Vaghela sir, Chairman, Telecom Regulatory Authority Board of India. Hemang sir?
Yes.
Yes, and your camera again, is not visible.
It's okay. There is some...
Yeah, I think okay. There are some technical issues. Yes, please continue, sir.
Yes, again, I'm given the responsibility of describing the vast field experience of Vaghela sir. Vaghela sir is the Chairman, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. Dr. P.D. Vaghela joined as Chairman, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India on 1st October 2020. Prior to joining TRAI, Dr. Vaghela was Secretary, Department of Pharmaceuticals, Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers. Dr. Vaghela had graduated in commerce in the year 1982. He did his MBA with specialization in financial management in 1984 and also obtained MA in development studies in the field of public policy and management from the Institute of Social Studies, The Hague in the Netherlands in the year 2005. He was decorated with a doctorate in the year 2013 in public management and policy by Sardar Patel University, Anand, Gujarat. Again, in this case, I can proudly declare, sir, you have your doctorate from Gujarat. So again, happy to know this, sir. He joined Indian Administrative Service, IAS, in 1986. He has held various assignments starting from district level to state level, during which he had won a number of awards for excellence as best collector and district magistrate and district development officer. In his assignment as chairman, Kandla Port, 2008 to 2013, the port was awarded as the best port for 5 years of his tenure. He also worked as chief commissioner of sales tax in Gujarat, during which period he has played a major role in drafting GST law, its rule, and fixing GST rates of goods and services as a convener of a national level GST law and GST fitment committees. He was closely involved in the GST implementation at national level as a key member of GST implementation committee. Still continuing, friends, as a Secretary of Pharmaceuticals, he has launched 4 ambitious schemes to transform the sector. He also works as the convener of Empowered Group 3, now EG2, which handled availability of critical medical supplies like PPE, N95, ventilators, and testing kits. Today, India is exporting these items for which India was otherwise dependent on imports during pre-COVID time. In May 2018, Dr. Wagela was honored by Honorable Prime Minister of India for excellence in public administration while appreciating his contribution in implementation of GST in India. With this wide, I can say, introduction of Wagela sir, I again hand over the session to Jain. Thank you.
With this introduction, I would like to welcome PD Wagela sir, IAS, for the proceed further. Yeah. Wagela sir, welcome.
Yeah. Thank you very much. And Professor C.N. Murthy, Dr. Jigar Inamdar, distinguished delegates, student participants, ladies and gentlemen. It is a great pleasure and privilege for me to talk to the academia and the students of renowned MS University. I would say renowned. And just to inform you that, you know, I am from Gujarat only, and I am from Ahmedabad. And you know, we you know, MS University has a glorious past. And it is one of the premier institutes of the country. And talking to the students is always a pleasure for me. And just to, you know, I would have come personally over there, but because of the COVID, it is not possible for me to travel to Vadodara. But let me tell you, you know, during the COVID, it is TRAI and the, you know, Department of Telecommunication is have kept you people connected. So today what we are talking about. So, you know, working from home was possible because, you know, the telecom and the TRAI and the all the stakeholders, you know, we increased the, you know, capacity of delivering the, you know, data and the call services to the people. And people started working from the home. So, you know, there was huge work which was done by the, you know, by the government in this regard. And this is the, you know, reason that during COVID, we could handle the epidemic in a better manner. So this is what I would like to say. Now, you know, before I start my presentation, I would like to, you know, say that, you know, whether we like it or not, digitalization of the economy and even digitalization of our life, you know, is a, you know, foreblown conclusion. And it is in the interest of everyone that, you know, we understand what are the implications of such digitalization. And we also understand what is the kind of technology, you know, handling this digitalization in the country. So this is one thing. Second thing which I would like to say is that whether we like it or not, technological disruptions and innovation is a thing which is happening every day, and telecom is not an exception. What I understand is that change is inevitable, and if we can understand this phenomena and if we can handle it properly, that will be very good. Because what happens that if technology disruption is not handled, those companies and those even, you know, economies, you know, they can have problems. They can have problem with regard to growth, and they can also have problem in the economies. So with this, I would request, share my presentation, and I will share my presentation. Just a moment, I will ask.
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Yeah, it is visible.
Just yeah, sir, it is visible.
Just a moment.
Huh.
Thank you. So, is it visible?
Yeah. Yes, sir, it is visible.
Yeah. So, you know, what Buddha said, you know, is aptly applicable to the, you know, technology. He said that everything is changed, and he used the word called anicca. Anicca means anitya. And that, you know, that means that nothing is permanent and everything changes. And seeing the, you know, sensing the need of the consumers and using the technology, using the technology for finding out a new product is the art which every new company or any existing company has to, you know, employ. I have some problem here. Just a moment. Can you see now? Okay. I will share my thoughts through a presentation on developing 5G ecosystem in India. There are certain technical details. In case of any clarification, our advisor is also here, Sri Abbas, and he can answer on any query. For deployment of 5G network, a whole ecosystem is required to be developed and deployed. And enabling regulatory and licensing policies are also required to be put in place. Before I talk about 5G, I will give an overview of the sector. So, you know, this is what the, you know, content of my presentation will be there. So, you know, I will cover various topics. I will talk about role of regulator and government departments, importance and impact of telecom on other verticals. Then we'll talk about exponential growth of telecom in India, technological disruptions. I talked about that, so response of regulators and policymakers, and what is the need of convergence. Then I will come to the subject of today's theme, that is 5G. What is 5G? Then we'll talk about what are the prerequisites for effective implementation of 5G, and that includes spectrum allotment and management. Then connectivities. That means strengthening and extending connectivity. And the third point is right of way. Fourth point is use of satellite communication. And then, you know, very, very important aspect for any citizen and any, you know, person is that privacy, security, and the data ownership and data monetization. And then another very, very important thing is that how can we use these technologies for the better, growth of the country and the people of India. And most important, whenever digitalization takes place, you know, there is a section of the society which gets excluded, and how we can include these people who are economic units, who are micro manufacturers, to the economy, how we enable and empower them so that they can become the part of the digital economy. This is very important. So, the role of regulator, that is the first thing we'll take. The role of the regulator and government is very crucial for enabling policies and ecosystem in place. There is very clear distribution of functions and power between regulator and government departments in India. So, you can see that, the TRAI is a statutory body established by an act of parliament known as TRAI Act 1997. Initially, the purpose was to regulate telecom services, but in 2004, TRAI was entrusted with the powers to regulate broadcasting and cable TV services as well. So therefore, TRAI today is regulating two sectors, telecom and broadcasting. And broad objective of the, TRAI is to protect the interest of service providers, protect the interest of consumers, that is most important, and then also to see and then promote and ensure orderly growth of these sectors. We have many, we use many methods to regulate the sector. And the main instrument which we use is one, we recommend to the government of India that they should do like this in order for, the growth of the, sector, and for, resolving the issues and handling the new technologies which come up. Second thing, we also do regulations, which are also called subordinate legislations, where we define rules and procedures. Third is, we also issue tariff orders. But largely TRAI, has left the tariffs as a core business, and we have we have allowed the market forces to work in this respect. And we also keep on issuing directions to service providers and implementing certain decisions, which you will be seeing now and then in the newspapers, that if some service providers make some mistakes, we also impose penalties and fines also if they, you know, the, if they, their services are not proper. So now, you know, this is a broad view which, you know, gives or how the, you know, the powers and function of, you know, handling this sector is there. So government agencies, you know, generally, largely ministries, you know, they make policies, they do licensing, and they also handle spectrum management. And try, as I told, you know, we recommend on new policies, policy and new technology, licensing framework, spectrum auction and pricing. For example, you must be reading that, you know, TRAI is now in process of, you know, preparing an ecosystem for 5G in which, you know, we will be recommending government on the price of the spectrum and how they should, you know, auction the spectrum. Also, we will be handling the other aspects of 5G. So that is what we do. And regulations, we have a lot of regulations. One regulation, very important regulation, interconnection of network between service providers. Without interconnection, you know, the mobile from one company, call from one telecom operator will not go to the other telecom operator. So that is what we do. Then we also handle largely quality of service of the mobile and wireless services. This is very important, but we do, you know, at a, you know, at an area level, and you know, and we bring out our reports very regularly, and then we naturally we also regulate some of the tariffs, not all tariffs. Largely, it is forbearance, and a very important thing is mobile number portability. We allow the, you know, mobile to be, you know, mobile from one, you know, the consumer to go from one company to another, and within three, as soon as he, you know, sends an SMS. So we issue instructions, as I already told, as and when required to the various telecom operators. Now, you know, I will bring out, you know, TRAI has come into existence since 1998, and whatever growth which you see in the broadcasting, you know, for example, there were not many channels, you know, in the broadcasting sector earlier, and now you can see there are more than 900 channels, and there are a lot of broadcasters which have come up. And there are huge growth of DTH and cable operators in the country. This is because of the, you know, policies and the recommendation made by the TRAI, and hence, you know, this was made possible. Coming to telecom, you know, we, for example, international long distance call, there are huge, you know, charges. But, you know, then TRAI came out with the with recommendation liberalizing the sector. And now, you know, now the you know, international call distance, long distance calls has come, the rates have come down, and it has resulted into establishment of huge submarine cable landing stations in India. And this also will help India in, you know, increasing its presence in you know, data park sector. We also came out with universal service obligation fund. This fund, you know, we recommended that government should create a fund, and this fund should be used for connecting the, you know, rural areas, hilly areas, and the you know, and the islands. And this fund has helped many of these areas to be connected. For example, you know, recently Andaman has been connected with laying an you know, the submarine cable. The same way, you know, areas like Arunachal Pradesh, Northeast, and Ladakh, and other areas also being covered. This is one thing. Also, you know, through this fund, a big ambitious project for BharatNet, in order to connect the villages, has also been implemented very successfully. We also, you know, the TRAI is one of the you know, few regulators in the world which went for technology neutral approach. That means the spectrum can be used for any technology, whether 2G, 3G, 4G, that is not important, but it can be used for any technology. So, and we, you know, TRAI is one of the few regulators which again does not interfere in the working of the market forces. And we believe in forbearance. And mobile number portability, I have already told you. Also, you know, because of the TRAI's policies, the sharing of the infrastructure, you know, India is one of the few countries which, you know, went for that. Now coming to, you know, the growth of telecom in India. Growth of telecom in India, you know, Digital India program has transformed the entire digital profile of the country. This program was started in December 2020. Today, 116.6 million, 1166 million, that is 116 crores, and, you know, people are using mobile phones and digital identities. And there are 833 million internet users, you know, today. And out of these 808 million use internet from mobile phones and dongles, which is 96% of the total web traffic. India's mobile data consumption is already one of the highest in the world. And over 300 million Indians regularly use social media. And the last year alone, over 200 million Indians took to mobile banking and digital payments. And this is, I think, one of the very, very highest figure in the world. Almost 20 crores people, went to the, banking, online banking and digital payment system. And with the support of telecom sector, this unified payment interface system, very unique system, has recorded 2.07 billion transactions worth rupees 386,000 crores. And this is, I think, one of the biggest unified payment interface in the world. Now, this table, will tell you about the our comparison and the kind of size of the telecom industry. The enormous size, for 135 crores of people, as I told you, 189 million people are using telephones. Then tele density is 88%. That is number of telephone per 100 persons. And tele density in urban is 139%. But there is a cause of concern because tele density in rural area is 59%, and we are working on that. The mobile penetration, you can see, total mobile subscribers, I told you, around 116 crores. And this includes both smart and feature phones. And total internet subscribers are 833 million. Internet penetration, it is still very low at per 100%, it's 61 in urban, but it is very high, 105, and rural it is 37. As soon as the BharatNet project gets completed, this figure is likely to improve. Data usage, you can see, India, subscriber, this is data usage, minute of usage per subscriber per month is 830 minutes, which is very, very high. And average data usage per subscriber per month is 14 gigabyte. And very, very competitive pricing. Average per gigabyte cost, worldwide cost is $8.53. And India, it is only 53 cents. It is not written here, but only 53 cents. And average data per GB data cost is is 10 rupees 95 paisa. Sorry, 10.95. So the average cost per gigabyte is 14 cents, not 53. I'm sorry, 14 cents. On the other hand, the world average is $8.53. Coming to the telecom economy as such, the gross revenue in the September quarter ending is 68,000 crores, and monthly average revenue per user is rupees 105, which is very, very low. And recently, after the recent increase in the telecom prices, this ARPU may go up, because this is very important that they also should have the revenue with them, because telecom is a very high capital intensive sector, and they require money if they want to keep on upgrading and expanding their infrastructure in the country. Now, coming to the global comparison, see, as you can see on the left hand side, internet tele density, India is 57.29. Arabian countries, it's 57.1. World average is 57. So we are, on the same thing, world average, and we need to work more. But compared to Asia and Pacific average, is 50, we are much better, but we need to improve on this. And as the internet connectivity increases, I think, this figure will go up. And the total internet subscribers per 100 population, you can see, though, blue chart, horizontal is shows India, then, developing countries is yellow, and the world is orange, and the developed country is gray. So you can see developed country is, it's very, very high, 88.8% 2019. But India has also improved from in 2014, you know, our internet subscribers per 100 population was only 31.5%, but now it has gone to 54.3%. And this is a huge change in the last 8-9 years. So again, you know, you can see data usage in some of the countries. We have made a comparison. So India is 14 gigabyte. Iceland is 11.3, Chile 9.9, Denmark is 9.6. So this is what, you know, so that way we can see India is one of the biggest telecom, sectors in the world. That is. Now coming to the digital economy and digital services in India. So, you know, there's a, you know, digital, the technology and connectivity has transformed the way we work and live. Most of the services are being provided by both now online by the private sectors and governments, which includes local bodies and other agencies. COVID has extended the process of digitalization, as I told earlier. I will talk about transformative initiatives by the government, which has helped government to reach out to the people, especially the poor and the other beneficiaries in form of DBT and access to other government services. So everybody knows, you know, about, Aadhaar, which is, you know, which connects more than, 1.32 billion Aadhaar, based digital identity. And this has allowed government to reach out the people, through the banks, directly transfer the, benefits to them and provide various, services to the, beneficiaries. Then, as I already told you about unified payment interface, which has now exceeded 4 billion transactions every month. And direct benefit transfer, in the current financial year alone, more than 360,000 crore have been transferred through DBT schemes. So, and this DBT, because of direct benefit transfer to the accounts of the beneficiary, there has been a huge savings and the corruption has gone down. Then another very important, initiatives, these common service centers, there are more than four, there are more than, 4.5 lakh service centers, including 2.5 lakh service centers, which have been, established in Gram Panchayat. And this has allowed online delivery of services by government, local bodies and other agencies to even those who are not digital literate or have no access to the digital means. So that means a villager can go to a service center and he can ask for the birth certificate, he can ask for the record of his land, or he can ask the record of the, he can also apply online for any of the scheme. So this is what, this is what the common service center is doing. And then BharatNet, I have already told you, is very, very ambitious project. Already 170,000 gram panchayats have been covered and 549,000 kilometers of optical fiber has been, this thing has been laid. GST, I have already, this 12.1 million businesses have brought onto a common digital platform by abolishing 13-14 taxes and, 13-14 registration, 13-14 return to be filed and all those and 13-14, 13 around, compliances to be made. So this is also has been possible, because of, digitalization of the economy. Now, the technology disruptions, is very, it's whether we like it or not. I told you in the beginning that technological disruption is a way of life. And if a company or if a person, if is not able to forecast the technological disruptions, there will be a problem. There are many companies which have gone out of existence just because, they have not predicted the technological disruptions. So hence, naturally the private people will be taking appropriate steps, but the role of government is very, very important in creating a vibrant ecosystem for handling such technological disruptions. And so that the, new technology which comes up, it can be harnessed properly and its benefits can go to the people and the various sectors of the economy. So that is one thing. And what we need to do is that, we need to foster broad public and consumer interest and limit any potential unintended negative consequences of these developments. That is one thing. Then, we are in an age where we can see a new generation of mobile communication in less than 10 years. So, we now, India is about to implement this 5G, and already now people are talking about 6G. Recently, Government of India has set up a 6G group. So, the technological disruption is very, very fast, and it comes, in a very, very in a very, very complicated manner. So in order to understand that, the regulator has to talk to all the stakeholders, experts, people, you know, professors, academia, so that, you know, they can work on this aspect and can tell what are the kind of regulations and facilitating role a regulator should play. So this is this is very, very important. Now another thing which is very, very important because of technological disruptions, there is a need of convergence in form of policies and regulations. There is convergence is taking place in the entire value chain of service delivery to end users. I will explain this by a chart also. The same content is being delivered in many formats and through multiple technology. This is another thinking. And like a news bulletin is getting delivered in different formats like text, audio, video, and through internet, radio, and TV. The device of consumption of news may be mobile, TV, tablet, computer, radio, etc. So, you know, this is what is happening. So here, you know, you can see it is now possible that the same content is being transmitted through different media. So this is the media. So media you can read. You know, the news bulletins are text, audio, video format in print or digital forms. You can see the content. So content, media is also content is getting converged, and then a network convergence is also taking place. So for a fixed broadband network processes voice, video, data, offering multiple services such as telephones, televisions, and the internet. Earlier, when you know in 20, 25 years before, the telephone was only providing voice call. Now it is able to provide all kind of services. So this network convergence has taken place. And last is technological convergence. So device may perform many types of functions and deliver many formats of content. And mobile is the best example. The smartphones, the smart TVs, wearable IoTs, industrial IoTs, smart city devices, and platforms. That means technological convergence in form of devices is also taking place. This requires that we the regulators and the government, they also think about converging their policies, their laws, and the various departments. And without this convergence and coordination, it is not possible to handle these technological disruptions and the convergence of technologies. Now I will come to the subject, which is 5G. I took some time because I wanted to explain what is happening in this field. So let me tell you, 5G already, trials have started very successfully in the country, and it is giving very, very good results. Government of India also funded a lot of test beds and research in 5G, and a lot of use cases have been identified. That is second thing. And third thing is that now, we are in the process of, we have already issued a consultation paper. You can go to our website and you can see the consultation papers in various subjects. And one subject is 5G. So, we think that within two, three months, we will be giving recommendation to government with complete ecosystem. And I think after that, government will go for auction. And the 5G will be then after the auction, the telecoms will implement the and deploy and roll out the 5G in the country. So what is 5G? As earlier professor mentioned, 5G is nothing but the fifth series of cellular technology, 2G, 3G, 4G, 5G. That 5G is the latest iteration of cellular technology that will provide seamless coverage, high data rate, low latency, and high reliable communication. It will increase energy efficiency, spectrum efficiency, network efficiency, as well as efficiency of all other systems. And 5G will also have use cases in many sectors, such as health, smart cities, industrial IoT, industry 4.0, emergency, disaster, and public safety, education, transport, etc. At present, 72 countries have already deployed 5G networks in the last 2 years, including USA, Japan, South Korea, China, Australia, UK, and other countries. So, I will explain this. I think earlier a professor was you know, he explained in a very nice manner. But, you know, there are many other parameters which I will explain. So this is, you know, this the key parameters, performance indicators of 5G, you know, the peak data rate. So this is peak data rate is 20 gigabit and of a BTS, that base transmitting section, you know, station, as compared to just 1 gigabyte in 4G. That means it is, you know, it is, you know, it is 20 times higher, the peak data rate. Then user experienced data rate is 100 Mbps, individual users, as compared to just 10. There is 10 times higher, you know, user experience, you know, data rate will be there compared to 4G. Then spectrum efficiency. Spectrum efficiency will go up by 3 times. That means the spectrum can be used, you know, in a 3 times, you know, better, you know, in 3 times higher rate compared to 4G technology. Then mobility, the speed of vehicle while using the mobile. So you are moving in a train or you are moving in a car. So, you know, this mobility, you know, the mobility is 500 kilometer hour speed as compared to 350 kilometer hour in 4G. So here also you can see the tremendous improvement. And latency, this is very, very important. Latency, you know, is 1 millisecond. That is time taken from origin to destination as compared to 10 millisecond in 4G, right? So that is again here, you know, already, you know, 10 times reduction in latency. So this will again, you know, this precision engineering, the precision, any, you know, any operation or any process where precision is required, for example, remote way of surgery, you know, here this latency comes to, you know, to great help. Then connection density, that means in a square kilometer, how many devices can be operated. So this is 10 lakh devices and per square kilometer, which is 10 times of 4G. Again, network energy efficiency, that is network, the, you know, network, how better it will be used, the network which was established by the telecom, which is 100 times power efficient than 4G. That means the power consumption will go down usually in 5G. And last but not least is area traffic capacity, that is 10 megabit second per square meter capacity, that is capacity available to each small area of 1 square meter, which is 100 times that of 4G. That you can see, you know, it's a transformational, technology. And this technology is going to, I will explain by 2 examples, actually, you know, these. But before that, you know, I will tell about 3 categories of use cases. I will talk about this. The 5G use cases, that is, one is enhanced mobile broadband. That is one, this thing, you know, use cases, how the use cases will come up, how it will be used. That is one, enhanced mobile broadband. Second is massive machine type communication. This will be largely used in industrial processes and in the industries and automation. Then ultra reliable, low latency communications. And 5G network will make available, you know, a much greater throughput, much lower latency, ultra high reliability, much higher connectivity density, and higher mobility range. Right? So this is what I wanted to tell. And now, you know, we will talk about the kind of use cases and related KPIs. So in enhanced mobile broadband, which will be the use cases? So here, virtual reality, augmented reality. Then this is the use case of 5G. Then second is video calling. Third is virtual meetings, broadband through fixed wireless access, ultra high definition video, video surveillance and monitoring, mobile cloud computing. This is, you know, use of enhanced mobile broadband. And in massive machine type communication, use cases will be wearables. You know, wearables, then social networking, healthcare monitoring, smart homes, smart cities, vehicles to infrastructure communications, and industrial automation. Ultra reliable, low latency communications, you know, use cases will be public safety, remote surgery, vehicle to vehicle communication, and industry 4.0. So this is this thing. And where it will be used, you know, which kind of sectors which it will be used. See, for example, agriculture. In agriculture, precision agriculture will be used. That means, you know, a plant, what kind of what, how much water it requires, whether it requires a water or not, and what kind of fertilizer it requires. You know, all this will be, you know, this precision agriculture is possible because of the, you know, possible because of 5G. Then healthcare, remote diagnostics, remote surgery, patient care, biovariables, food sensors, equipment monitoring, elderly monitoring, and these are the various uses of 5G. In manufacturing industrial automation, already the transformation has started. Many companies, especially automobiles and civil aviation in the manufacturing of the, you know, air planes, you know, this has already started. And so you know, their industry 4.0, the next industrial revolution, which will take place, and it will include industrial systems and sensors, which allow machine-to-machine communication, use of robots, and use of artificial intelligence, AR and VR. Mining, smart mining with use of sensors and robotics. Now, you know, you need not send any worker in the mines. You know, the robots, they can go inside and they can extract, and, you know, the vehicles also, driverless vehicle will go, and they will, you know, they will bring the, you know, mine materials outside. Even if the mine is, you know, likely to collapse, the sensors will immediately tell that, and even these vehicles can be taken out. Already in Germany and many other countries, you know, the smart mining has started. Education, again, use of augmented reality, virtual reality in education. Energy and grid power, smart grid and automation. This will reduce, especially transmission loss, you know, huge transmission loss. So this will reduce, and they will also be able to, you know, they monitor the, you know, use of the electricity by the consumers. Then automotive industries, autonomous cars, you know, this everyone knows, you know, everyone reads in the newspaper. Smart cities, you know, smart and automated municipal services, smart buildings, waste management, temperature control, water distribution, all this. And gaming and sports is going, you know, this is the sector which is going up and coming up very, very fast. And it basically esports and real-time gaming will be possible due to 5G. And last but two things, financial markets, real-time stock monitoring and trading will be possible. In addition to this, there are two other sectors which I would like to talk about. Smart homes. Everybody know you will be interested. So in homes, you know, variable smart thermostat, pad feeding, smoke alarm, refrigerators, washer, home security, all this, you know, will become ultra efficient and, you know, very useful to the people. Then transport and urban mobility. I talked about transport, but here traffic routing, telematics, smart parking, and public transport. These are the, new use cases which will come up. Now, you know, just to give one example, earlier professor was explaining, but I will take one case of mobile downtime, download time. So HD movie, if suppose it's 4.7 gigabyte, download time in 4G networks takes around 41.7 minutes, right? And in 5G, it will take only 2 minutes. You can see download time in 5G network, right? So you know, 15 Mbps takes 41.7 minutes, but 300 Mbps in 5G will take only 2 minutes, right? Same way, 50 Mbps 4G download speed, and I that at 12.5 minutes at present. In 5G, 1 Gbps, and it takes 37.2 seconds. And 10 gigabytes, a video can be downloaded in just 3.76 seconds. So this is the power of 5G technology. So same again, coming to low latency use cases, self-driving cars. Say when it comes to connected driving, data must be transmitted and a reaction triggered in real time, because decision has to be made in fraction of a second. Only in this way, the car can stop before hitting an obstacle or take evasive action, right? That is one thing. And so reaction time of a human between detecting a hazard and pressing the brake pedal is 1 second. An automobile doing 100 kilometers per hour travels around 28 meters in 1 second. So that means, you can see this formula in 27.7 meters. So an autonomous vehicle which can analyze data with a latency of 1 millisecond using 5G networks, it can react in 1000 millisecond. That is what, so distance travel. So the reaction time between the human eye and the brain is around 10 milliseconds. With latency of 1 millisecond, real communication between connected machines and devices become feasible for the first time, for instance, in industry 4.0 in the remote surgery. So this is very, very important that, you know, the in a fraction of milliseconds, you know, the activity, you know, will travel. This is one thing. So now, you know, coming to what do you require to implement 5G? Because, you know, it requires very, very calibrated approach, and it requires some sort of an ecosystem. Only then 5G can be implemented. So, you know, first requirement is, you know, you require spectrum, both for access and backhaul. Second, you require broadband connectivity. This connectivity can be given through fixed wireless, Wi-Fi hotspots, and fixed wireline, right? And required infrastructure will be towers, you know, towers, then, you know, this thing, wireline, cables, aerial on the ground and under the ground, and ducts, you know, on the roads, so that, you know, it can reach to the villages, the, you know, cables can reach to the villages, and there, you know, again, the, you know, cable can be laid, and the connectivity can be given. Another very important thing is, you know, ROW and IBS, the co-sharing. So ROW permissions, all these permissions, infrastructure, you know, permissions will be required. So that is very important. And we can now, because the technology has changed, now satellite, you know, satellites can be, has been used for communication, but now satellites can be used for low bit connectivity, and it can also be used for providing broadband satellites. So these are the things, you know, where TRAI and the government of India is required to prepare appropriate ecosystem, come out with regulatory regime, and you know, prepare you know, appropriate facilitating you know, facilitating framework, so that, you know, these all things happen very fast. Here the support of the local authorities, you know, approvals of the ROWs and other things becomes very, very critical. I will talk about this now. So spectrum, you know, the I little, you know, spectrum for access and backhaul. So here, you know, broadband connectivity is, you know, this I have already told, so I'll go ahead. Right. So now, you know, let us come to this spectrum. This is what, you know, what is spectrum? So spectrum, you know, it actually refers to the radio waves. These are the, you know, electronics waves from lower frequency to very high frequencies. For telecommunication, we refer the radio waves to those microwave band frequencies which are extending from 300 megahertz. Here, you know, this from the left side, if you see, if you left side, you see, first, you know, use the broadcast radio and television, this up to 700 megahertz, if you can see frequency range. Now, here, radio and other things are used. And then, you know, this between 300 megahertz to 300 gigahertz, you know, these are the cooking, radar, telephones, and other signals. So, but, you know, so so we can see the chart in various band of frequencies used for different purposes. For example, you know, this 30 PHS and to 30 KHS, this is used for, you know, to view inside of the bodies and objects. So, you know, actually, I'm not a technical person, but, you know, these are the waves which are used for various purposes. As far as, you know, 5G is concerned, you know, it will be, you know, the waves between 300 megahertz to 300 gigahertz will be used. So now, internationally, you know, the telecom spectrum is managed and harmonized by International Telecommunication Union. The world is divided in three regions. Region one is primary Europe, that is, you know, primary Europe, Middle East, and Africa. Region two is North America, Canada, and Latin America, that is blue. And then region three, that is, you know, is Asia Pacific region, which is, you know, pink in color. We are in region three. ITU does the harmonization frequency used in discussion with all the members of the country of the three regions. And based on this ITU radio regulations, the member states update their frequency allocation table for spectrum use of the different services. Right? Then for as far as 5, you know, 5G is concerned, you know, the for deployment of 5G, there are certain inputs which are essential. Such as spectrum, I told, you know, spectrum, that is access spectrum and the backhaul spectrum. And access spectrum used for radio access network, and backhaul spectrum used for connecting mobile towers to core network. I will explain by a chart. Radio network and core network elements and infrastructure, mobile, mobile towers, optical fibers, that is infrastructure. So here you can see this diagram. You know, this diagram shows the access part and the backhaul part in a mobile network architecture. You can see this is on the right hand side, RNC that the core network is, you know, maintained by the telecom operators. The RNC also is maintained by them. And then backhaul is, you know, it connects, RNC is connected with the tower. So this is called, you know, backhaul, right? And then this EU is user equipment, that is mobile handset, which gets latched on to a base transmitting stations. So, you know, this, this base transmission stations and the spectrum used here is called access spectrum. So here, this is access. So this is the tower and this is the mobile on UE is mobile. And node B, which is written there, is, you know, this is the tower. Here, you know, BTS is put on the tower. So, you know, this is the access. And between node B tower, this tower and the RNC, this is called backhaul. Here, you know, you require connectivity between, you know, this, all the, you know, connectivity between RNC and the, you know, tower, and from tower to the mobile. This is this thing. So, and there are different bands for access spectrum, such as 700 megahertz band, as far as access spectrum, which are the bands. So there are different bands for access spectrum, such as 700 megahertz band, 800 megahertz band, 900 megahertz band, 1800 megahertz, and 2100 megahertz band. These are very important for 5G. Actually, these are also used for 4G and can be used for 5G, because technologically now, you know, the advancement is such that, you know, this these are called mid band. This can be used for, you know, 5G also. And then node B and is connected to core network through radio network controller, which is a kind of aggregator. So this is radio net, network aggregator. So I told from the tower to the RNC, the microwave spectrum used. Node B to B and RNC is called backhaul spectrum. So for 5G network, high capacity backhaul links will be required. Now next, so 5G, in 5G needs spectrum within three key frequency ranges to deliver widespread coverage and support all use cases. That is, as you can see, sub 1 gigahertz. These bands are below 1 gigahertz. For example, 600 megahertz, 700 megahertz, 800 megahertz, and 900 megahertz. Now, these bands cover indoor and the coverage and indoor coverage. And that is why they are called coverage bands. However, the data rate capacity is very, very low. Then, 1 to 6 gigahertz. These bands are called coverage and capacity bands. At this frequency, provide moderate coverage in terms of data speed. These bands are 1800 megahertz, 2100 megahertz, 2300 megahertz, 2500 megahertz, and 3300 to 3670 megahertz. And this band is called midband, and which is part of the satellite C band reframe for mobile use. And third one, this about 600 gigahertz. And this is called super data layer, as the data rate capacity in these bands are very, very high. And the most important range in this MM wave band is 4.25 to 27.5 gigahertz as per the ITU regulation. In India, we are going to use 24.25 to 28.5 gigahertz. Other IMT bands identify ITU are further higher, such as 37 to 43.5, 40.55 to 47. I will not go into the details, but for as far as India is concerned, we'll be using 600, 700, 800 megahertz, 900 megahertz. Then we'll be also using, as I, this 1800 megahertz, 2100 megahertz, 2300, 2500. And C band, which is very, very important, 3300 to 3670. And, this MM wave, 24.25 to 27.5. So this, all the three bands will be appropriate, be used in such a manner that the 5G, can be deployed. This is very important. So the spectrum allocation will be done in all the three bands. Now 5G, ecosystem is currently available in, three bands. I have already told about this, so I will not repeat this, we can skip this. So now this diagram, you can see. So, in order to understand why this, what is the difference between various, spectrum. So the diagram shows the comparison of coverage, capacity, and latency in lower bands, mid bands, and higher bands. For lower bands, the coverage is large, but the capacity is very low, and latency is very high. For mid bands, we have moderate values of coverage, capacity, and latency. Whereas for higher bands, the coverage is low, capacity is very high, and latency is very low. As per the requirement of different use cases, the service provider have to use the bands. Right? And now, 5G spectrum for backhaul. We talked about the backhaul, connecting the, you know, RMC with the towers. So this, as explained, you know, earlier, for 5G network, high capacity backhaul links will be required. TRAI has, we have already recommended that we should use UE band, that is 71 to 76 gigahertz and 81 to 86 gigahertz, and B band, that is 57 gigahertz to 64 gigahertz. And, you know, this is what we have already recommended, and government will consider this and an appropriate, and then it can be used for the 5G. And another thing, you know, the, you know, now we will discuss the various means of providing broadband. So this is also very important. So, you know, here is, you know, you can see the broadband connectivity can be provided through cellular, you know, fixed wireless, then FTTH and Wi-Fi hotspots, right? So this is the thing. So here you can see, this is the, you know, this will explain. In this diagram, we have shown that various forms of broadband connectivity. So cellular connectivity, fixed wireless access through cellular network, creating Wi-Fi hotspots, providing fiber to the home. And the diagram also shows that how BharatNet is helpful in providing all such kind of connectivity in rural areas where the BharatNet fiber is reached. So, you know, this is very clear. You can see this, you know, all the three different kind, you know, the different kind of connectivity, you know, can be provided using, you know, you can use either the, you know, fixed wireless access, that is nothing but using a spectrum, or, you know, sending the beams, that instead of the cable, and then cellular technology, you know, this is using the, you know, spectrum, that is one thing. And that's, then, you know, Wi-Fi, putting up the Wi-Fi, and most important is the fiber to home through cable in the, you know, home, you can provide the connectivity. So, this is again, we are trying to show what is fixed wireless access. This is going to be most important in India, because, you know, the cost of laying cable is very, very high, and fixed wireless, you know, can has, you know, the wireless access can help us, you know, and it can reduce the cost of, you know, laying the cables and, you know, other things. So it is very important for 5G technology, from the base station, a broadband connection can be provided through radio access network, and a wall mounted CPE device is used at, you know, customer's home. So, you know, this is, you know, this is also very, very important technology, which will be used in 5G. Now coming to, you know, right of way, towers, cables, and in-building solution. The timely permission to get right of way from the local authority for laying cables, installation of mobile towers, and access to the building is crucial for 5G system. As the 5G involves higher spectrum bands, the, you know, cell size is small, and therefore large number of small cells will be required to be installed. Support of local body is essential in this regard. And the, you know, the worry about, you know, health and other things, I think, you know, it is, I know it is ill-timed, and I think, you know, there is no study which shows that, you know, the 5G or the 4G impact the health. Though there may be, in, you know, civil aviation, there is a technical solution which can be used when it comes to using the 5G in the airplanes. And so, you know, this, I have already told, I will not go into that, but we have already recommended that there should be national ROW policy, and no Nagarpalika, Mahanagarpalika, or the local body, you know, should delay giving the permissions, because, you know, it is very simple that, you know, only those states, only those cities, and only those areas will prosper which have got very, very good infrastructure, you know, telecom infrastructure. And we want, you know, we have recommended that a national, you know, national council should be set up, and all the state governments and the local bodies and central governments should sit together and come out with a model law, so that, you know, this permission is very, very important, that permissions are given, no, you know, have very heavy charges are, you know, taken from the telecom operators, because the cost of laying this infrastructure is very, very high. So satellite, and that I have, you know, the last which, you know, in this, you know, connectivity, satellite can be, of course, can be used for providing connectivity to remote and far-flung areas, but the terrestrial connectivity is difficult to reach. Recently, government, for example, have used satellites to provide, you know, provide connectivity in Arunachal Pradesh, in Sikkim, in Ladakh, and in many, many other areas. So, you know, this is also very, very important, and we are going to recommend, you know, we have already recommended, you know, low bit connectivity, and that will be, I think, is being considered by the government. We are also going to recommend providing broadband connectivity to satellite. We have already issued a consultation paper in this regard. So this I have already told. I will not tell about this. You know, satellite can be used for connecting far-flung areas. So now, you know, very, very important. I think this will be of interest to everyone, including the youth, because they are always worried about privacy of their data and where they talk and the security of their data. So, you know, this is very, very important. And we try, you know, as in 2018, we have already, you know, recommended government that, you know, the you know, privacy, you know, we need to bring a law to handle the privacy security of the personal data. And and you know, already you know, government India, you know, this draft law bill was prepared. That bill went to the you know, parliamentary committee, and now parliamentary committee has, you know, you know, finalized the bill, and the bill is at present in consideration. But you know, this is very, very important, because an investor who comes in, you know, and sets up, you know, the data parks or data centers, or a person who, you know, who handles data, you know, that you know, privacy and security of data is very, very important. And you know, the kind of cyber you know, the problem of hacking and the, you know, the hacking and creating problems and disrupting the telecommunication and the, you know, the digital network is also a very big problem. So I think, you know, this kind of law will be very, very important. This is, we have already recommended. And last but not least, you know, we need to you know, have a calibrated approach. See what happens whenever a new technology comes. You know, this technology is, you know, its use is made by the people, you know, who have the, you know, access to this, you know, access to the technology, and who have the wherewithal. So in India, you know, the internet penetration is very, very low. And ITU report states that 87% people are using internet in developed countries compared to 44% developing countries. In India, you know, the internet penetration went up to nearly 61% in 2021 from just, you know, 4% in 2007. But we still, we consider this still very low, 61%. We need to reach to, you know, the you know, level of the developed countries. And for every Indian citizen with an internet subscription, there is a citizen in a rural area who lacks one. This is very, very important, because in rural areas, people are, you know, they need to be given access and this thing. And there is a sizable percentage of country people living in the regions where internet access is minimal. And there exists a digital divide, as the rural internet penetration is only 37% against national average of 61%. And we need to bridge this digital divide by making enabling policies for digital inclusion. So what is digital, you know, this, what is digital inclusion? You know, it actually, you know, it covers four aspects. That is, one, it needs to ensure one connectivity. That means everyone should have a, you know, good connectivity. That is one thing. Second, affordability. That means the rate or the price of the connectivity should not be very, very high. And third is device availability. That means they should have access to a good device. For example, at least for a student, a child of a poor parents, and if he's studying in a school, you know, he should have, you know, at least a good device, so that, you know, he can access online education. This is what, you know, is meant by device availability. So you know, maybe and a country can be considered prosperous when the last person is uplifted and included in the mainstream and becomes part of the digital economy. And the need of the hour is to, you know, focus on digital inclusion, digital access, digital skills, digital literacy, creation of jobs and economic units in rural India, skill change. These are the aspects which we need to, you know, focus. And I'm very happy to share with you that, you know, we are going to come out with our consultation paper and to handle these aspects. We also have recommended to government for, you know, removing license fee on fixed line, which is being laid by the telecom operators and internet service providers and infrastructure providers. So this is, you know, very important. So I need not tell you, but the government has, you know, prepared an holistic plan for, you know, manufacturing in the country. So this was mentioned by one of the professors in the beginning. A lot of PLI schemes have come up, and you can see that, you know, India has now become biggest menu, mobile manufacturers in the country, and we have started exporting also. And another PLI scheme has come out with large scale electronic manufacturing. Then PLI scheme from IT hardware has come up, and all these schemes have become very, very successful. Recently, government has declared a huge package of ₹76,000 crores. This will make India self-sufficient in the, chips. So this is a fab, this industries, will be given incentives. Because, 5G, one thing is very clear, that the kind of devices which will come up, IoT devices, where, this kind of chips will be required in a very large scale. You must have read recently that, some of the, automobile dealers, the manufacturers could not deliver cars because the chips were not available. There is a huge shortage of chips in the country. And, the Honorable Prime Minister very recently, declared this a very, very, very ambitious plan of making India self-sufficient, not only making India a very big player when it comes to, manufacturing of fab chips. So, this is what I was, we recently have declared a telecom reforms. You can see the, there was issues with some of the telecom operators, and there were a lot of rigidities, and there were a lot of negativities about some of the provisions. So we removed that. I will not talk about that because I've taken enough time. And thank you very much. What I would request that you can ask any question. If there is any technical question, my request is that Mr. Abbas will reply to that. It was slightly technical, and I thought I will talk about this thing. In the end, what TRAI needs to do and what in government of India needs to do is to create an appropriate ecosystem, create a regulatory framework which is user-friendly, investor-friendly, and see that every person, the last mile connectivity is given, and every person, the poorest person, gets the connectivity. See, one thing I will tell you, what can happen if, because of 5G, because all the plants will be Industry 4.0. They'll be using machine-to-machine communication. They'll be using robots. They'll be using AI, AR, VR. And on those MSMEs, which does not have the wherewithal, they don't even know anything. So what will happen, because they say that because of Industry 4.0, the cost of production will come down by almost 10 to 15%. Now, MSME will not be able to compete. A lady who is manufacturing something, handmade things, handmade, for example, idol statues, she will not stand a chance, because the product which will be manufactured or which will be made, a statue which will be made using a plant which is 5G enabled, which will be much more precise, much more beautiful, and actually less costly. So what we are worried is that these people, all the people, women artisans, fishermen, farmers, workers, micro units, they all need to be helped. They need to be given connectivity. They need to be given devices. They need to be given digital literacy so they can become part of the digital economy. Otherwise, they will be left out. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for such a nice session. And thanks, sir, for giving us such an excellent outline of the ongoing deployment work in India for 5G spectrum. And I am sure it is going to be very successful under your able leadership. Yeah. The benefit of 5G will be enjoyed by the entire India in future. Thanks a lot, sir, for such an informative session.
Sir, there are so many questions which have been asked. So can I request Mr. Abbas? Abbas, can you go one by one and can you try to reply? Because there are some questions and we would like to... Abbas, yes. Can you reply?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Actually,
yes, sir. For the...
Some of the questions I have written in the...
Sir, my video is not visible because I had switched it off. There is no interference.
Sir, interference. Actually, when I started the session with the difference between the 4G and 5G, I just told about the speed difference in speed and latency. Sir has made the session so informative, not only technically, but also the policies of the government And it is like techno-commercial. The commercial aspect of the program and technical details of the program. Sir has made it excellent informative idea. Secondly, sir, there are, I can say, flood of the questions in the chat box. And I surprised with all the questions, sir, Tosif Abbas sir has continuously answered most of the questions. I just will try to summarize here a few questions to Tosif sir.
Taylor sir, what I would request, Mr. Abbas, he will go through that because he knows which are the questions I have covered. And, you know, he can just, you know, wherever it is not covered, he will reply.
Yes, fine, fine. That is
okay. Because, you know, when students ask, you know, we should satisfy them fully. We may take 5-10 minutes more. But, you know, right. It's very important that, you know, they know, you know, what is happening. Abbas, aap bol sakte hain aapka?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So, some of the questions which are not answered, so I will try to answer them. That one question is there. Is there any human health issue with 5G technology? So, as of now, there are no study which tells that there are any human health issues. And ICNIRP, that is the International Commission on Non-Ionizing Radiation, so they have come out with their parameters that they should be within that limit. And India is 1/10 of those parameters. So we are well safe. There is no EMF issue as far as human health is concerned. The next question is, as we understand that 5G requires advanced technological setups and communication. So, sir, how this will reach to villages and will they be able to take it advantage? So, yes, it is equally important for village also. And the spectrum, which is in lower band, say 700 or 800. So that will be suitable for providing the coverage in rural areas. And many applications which will run on this rural 5G network, like it is used for agriculture, it is used for industrial automation. So there will be a lot of industry and other things in rural areas. Even in health sector also in rural for remote health diagnostic and all. So these networks will be required in rural areas also and it will be taken up there. And then further question is that true that we can get 10 times more speed in 5G than 4G? Definitely we are going to get more than 10 times.
More than 10 times.
Yes. Then the question, is it also a very high wavelength which is harmful? So 5G will operate on high frequency. The wavelength will be very low, but there is no harm from the high frequency. Basically, all these radio frequency, they are emanating the radiation, EMF radiation, which is called non-ionizing radiation. So this will give only heating effect. So there is no damage to the cell or anything. So there will be no biological changes. So that is why there is no harm from these frequency bands also. How 5G will change the future? So future is going to be transformed digitally. Our chairman, sir, has already explained how the digital transformation is going to help the day-to-day social fabric as well as industry, entrepreneurs, everyone. So definitely it is going to change. And can we get satellite internet on 5G devices? So basically there are researches are going on to have the handset phone, which will direct connect to the satellite and get the better speed. Right now also this is available, the Inmarsat, Iridium, Global Star. They are the satellite operator who are providing the global satellite phone service, but the speed is less than 1 Mbps.
And the cost is very high.
So once the LEO constellation, the low Earth orbit constellations are coming, and then other research is going on in 3GPP to get the satellite-based 5G connectivity on directly on the handset. So that will take some time, but it has to come. And then
I can reply one Abbas before that.
Yes,
one question has been asked that, you know, what are the technical advancements needed for deployment of 5G spectrum in India? This is very, very important question. You see what happens. I told you that technology may come. And if we do not, you know, deal it with in a very calibrated manner by preparing an ecosystem, you know, the technology, you know, will bypass people, you know, largely, you know, middle class and, you know, small and medium and micro enterprises. So it is very important that, you know, the vertical sector. So we have written to all the secretaries of the various sectors, for fisheries, you know, fisheries department, then agriculture department, education department, and, you know, labor department, all and textile, all economic ministries. that, you know, we have asked them two, three things to be done, to do. One, that, you know, they should prepare the list of the stakeholders, you know, which requires handholding in the form of digital literacy, providing them connectivity, providing them, you know, devices. At least those who are below poverty line, you know, they can be provided devices. This is one thing. Secondly, much more than that, see, 5G, a lot of use cases have to be made. You have a technology, but if you do not convert this technology into use cases and applications, you know, it will not be used by the people. Now, you know, common people cannot use this technology. So that means, you know, government need to come forward. They have to use the academia, they have to use the research institutes, and they have to use the startups. And so we have asked these departments to prepare a platform and invite ideas, and from the, you know, engineers, from the students, from the researchers, from the academia, what kind of use cases they would like to, you know, develop, and then, you know, provide them help, necessary help, banking and finance and, you know, handholding, so that, you know, these use cases can come up in large scale, in a very massive scale, so the cost of the, you know, use cases go down. So, for example, you know, I was talking to someone, example I will give, that a fisherman goes to the, you know, goes for fishing, and then, you know, he, if he has got the 5G connectivity, he can take the photo of the fish which he has caught, you know, which he, you know, caught, which he has caught, and then, you know, that photo will be in three dimension. He can put this photo in the, you know, in a platform where all the, you know, purchasers are over there, and even before he reaches to the shore, the fish will be sold, and money will be, you know, can be debited or credited to his account. So this is the use. Here the fish will be shown in three dimensions. And exactly. So these are the use cases which, you know, people have to prepare. And naturally, a fisherman cannot afford this kind of connectivity. So he has to be helped. So how to help them is very, very important. So this is one thing I will say right now. And what else was there? Now, 5G is not deployed right now. That is true. We are not deployed. We will deploy now because, you know, there were certain issues in implementing this 5G because India had given some of these a spectrum to certain user agencies. So, you know, they had to be vacated. Once they vacate, and so for vacating them, or, you know, asking them to vacate was itself was a huge, you know, problem and cost involved. So that now has been done, and the spectrum has become by and large clean. So it can be given. Yes. Babash, you can cover other things.
Yeah, mostly has been covered. Someone has raised a question that is there some radiation effects of 4G network with comparison to 5G? So actually the radiation effect is not linked to the technology. So what we are doing that we measure the EMF value at one point of location coming from all the BTS, whether it is 4G, 3G, 2G. So the sum total of the EMF radiation should be lower than the prescribed limit. So that is the criteria. So therefore there is no harm how many towers we are putting, how many technology we are going. It has to be lower than the prescribed limit every point of time.
Yeah.
So what I think, sir, almost all the questions are very well answered by Bas, sir. There is, one last interesting question, which I think we should end the question and answer session. Sir, there is one question, rumors in the social media. Uh-huh. Stating that due to introduction of 5G tower testing, virus like corona spreading, because it is the important question to prevent situation.
You know, Juhi Chawla,
virus like corona spreading across the world, would you agree with this?
Juhi Chawla had gone to the court, it was dismissed. The let us wait for the verdict. But no. There is no such evidence, there is no such conclusion made by anyone. I think, you know, corona phailta hai and virus phailta hai and chidiya mar jati hai, what all this is, I don't know, nothing like that, because you know, test is going all over the country, and these tests are very, very positive, and we don't find anything like this, because in Delhi only the test is going, nearby in Gurgaon, I personally went there, so no, that is not right.
So definitely, sir, with a lighter note, if you permit, end the question and answer session, sir.
Mm-hmm.
If you permit, sir, we'll end the question and answer session.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Yes. So over to Jayant again.
Thank you very much, sir, for a question and answer session. Now, I would like to invite Sakshi Mehta to introduce Dr. Satyajit Chaudhary, sir, Vice Dean, Faculty of Technology and Engineering, who may deliver concluding remarks and vote of thanks.
It's my great honor and pleasure to introduce Dr. Satish Chaudhary, sir. He's a Vice Dean of Faculty of Technology and Engineering. He's also the Head of Department of Textile Engineering. He's a Senate and Syndicate member of the Maharaja Sharji University of Baroda. He's also former President of Pharmacy Union. His work area in polygonal modern composites, electromagnetic sealing and textile. To his credit, he has 40 published research paper in Indian National Journal. He's also published 3 books and 1 book as an editor. With this, I would like to over to for further questions.
Thank you so much, Sakshi. Really, sir, we are very much thankful to you for giving such an, you can say, informative, techno-commercial, and very in a very comfortable manner. We could understood that, yes, what is 5G? What are the advantages of this technology? What are the challenges you are going to face? What is the policy matter about this technology? So on behalf of Faculty of Technology and Engineering, I'm very much thankful to Dr. P.D. Vaghela, sir, for delivering such, you can say, the enlightening lecture on 5G deployment in India. So thank you so much, sir, for sparing your valuable time, because we know that what is your responsibility at national level. So you are so busy and you have taken time to us. So thank you so much, sir. Also, I'm thankful to Abbas, sir. Yeah, I'm thankful to Abbas, sir, for replying the queries and also the team of this organizing team, you can say, who have worked a lot day and night to establish for marketing, or you can say the connecting people to give this advantage of your lecture, sir. So very much thankful to Jayant, especially thank to you. This was his initiative.
Yeah, actually, Jayant was after me.
Yeah,
in the last 2 months.
So when I was president, I met him and found very potential. And he's a law student. So
very good.
Whenever he takes a job in his hand, he never leave it. So this is what his result. So very much thankful to Jayant that organizing such event. I'm also very much thankful to Jigar Bhai Inamdar, who is a team leader of MS University, who is leading the syndicate. So, and also a very young, dynamic guy. And dealing with the government also. So very much thankful to Jigar Bhai for sparing time. I'm also very much thankful to Professor C.N. Murthy, who is also again a very busy person in university, who is a Dean of Faculty of Technology and Engineering. So I'm thank you so much, Murthy sir. Apuro sir could not remain present because he had some urgent meeting. So I'm also very much thankful. He's heading our computer center. And this subject belongs to him only. He's only teaching this 5G technology related things. And additionally, sir, I would like to inform you that we have one 1980 batch alumni who are organizing different programs where they have proposed 5G technology for students. So in future, we will we have a curriculum on this technology. So we will need your help also in future. So we'll remain in contact with you, sir.
Sure.
Thank you so much. Yeah. So, and especially thanks to Hemang Taylor, sir, who are looking after on behalf of Faculty of Technology and Engineering for the successful organizing this program. So especially thanks to Hemang, sir. And the whole team of this with the Jayant that day and night who were working with him. So thank you so much. And if I forgot anyone's name, I thank to them also who have directly or indirectly supported for making this program as a success. So thank you so much. Thank you so much to one and all. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Finally, sir, sharing with a lighter note again, that sir is the student from Gujarat and ma'am is the student of Faculty of Technology Engineering. So sir, it is our privilege to have you, sir, as a guest sometimes when prevailing
situation. I will come there.
We personally invite you to come to the faculty and share your experience and thoughts to us personally. Along with this, I can also assure you, sir, that whatever support and infrastructure will be needed when the future programs you have suggested will be there between the authority and the university of this university. So with that, ending this session with all the, sir, finally, I can say that you spared your valuable time for students. So it is their benefit, sir. We are then very much thankful to you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for your valuable time. And Satyajit, sir, for a vote of thanks and concluding remarks. Now we are almost ready to the end of session. Before that, I would like to invite Meet Patel to play the national anthem. And I would like to request everyone to stand up at your place for the national anthem.
जन गण मन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड़ उत्कल बंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
Thank you, Meet, for playing National Anthem. Thank you, everyone, for joining us and making this possible. I hope that we will have many more interactive sessions in future too. Thanks all, and have a great day ahead. Special
thank you very much, Chairman. Thank you. Good day, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Hemang sir, for your valuable support. Without your support, it is not possible us to do the session.
Actually, it is the restless efforts from you and Khushi and all your team. Thank you from my side to you.
Thank you, sir.
Another thank you for like your
support. Thank you, the whole team, Meet Patel and Sumit, Shakshi, yes, everyone. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
Thanks, sir.
Value?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
We will end the meeting. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.